Good evening, everyone. Welcome back to my lecture on cultural studies and John Fiske's television culture. In the first part of my lecture, we discussed over the tenets of cultural studies, or we can say what a cultural studies or a researcher
in the first part of my lecture
in a researcher in cultural study, what he can do. And then we have gone through a brief life of John Fiske, who is a media critic and a literary critic. And also we have seen some ideas about the cultural studies proposed by John Fiske. And then we entered into the seminal book, The Television Culture, which is a epoch-making one. And it also gives us the whole idea about the television culture, how and how it is influencing the masses. Writer gave us the information about different tele serials which were initiated from the beginning of the television introduced. So some of the serials, they were initially aired on radio, they were shifted into the television, and they were go on, you say, presenting or go on every airing for many years. And with the introduction of variety of subject matter for television series or television programs, writer John Fiske applies different theories from interdisciplinary way and then try to unfold the shackles of the television programs. Or we can see that John Fiske exposes the very motif of television programs. And here, this entire book discusses that intentions of television programs. So in the beginning, writer gives us the whole idea how a teleprogram or television program is composed or prepared. So what are the different elements are involved in the making of a television program? And then later, writer applies different theories and he tried to expose or try to get the real intention behind all these serials. So we were somewhere in the chapter, the activated text. And in the activated text, writer is talking about the primary television text, which is the pattern of signifiers on the screen and in the airwaves at any one time. So here writer taking clue from the theory of Ferdinand de Saussure, that is from structuralism, where sign is composed of signified and signifier. So here television text is a kind of a signifier, as John Fiske found. And these television knowledges are not confined to television itself. There is a whole publicity industry producing secondary text. So the primary text, which is adopted for a storyline based on certain narration, but then there is a secondary text is introduced with the propaganda, or we can say that the journalistic criticism or gossip of the stars, specialist magazine for the fans, novelization, television scripts, advertisement, posters. So these are the various ways are there through which you can say a secondary text related to the television program has been composed. And then there is, according to John Fiske, third level of text is also introduced, and that is the reading that people make of television. So a certain program has a certain group of viewers, and they do interpret of their own, or they apply their understanding to the particular program and they derive certain meaning out of it. So this is the third level of, you see, text, which is introduced by, or you can say understood by, the readers. Then writer talks about the text in detail. So the first text is written by a writer. So writer is a writer of a book or a script writer. And in this way, that is a primary text is written by the writer. So here you see television need to be popular in a society composed of variety of groups with different, often conflicting interests, require its text to be what Eco calls open. So here television text is supposed to be open-ended. Now why it is open-ended? Because here the viewers and different specialists are there to give their opinion to the program. That is unlike movie and some literature. You see, movie and a literature somehow sometimes is a closed-ended, but television is supposed to be open-ended always. So in this way, the writerly text is multiple and full of contradiction, and it foregrounds its own nature as discourse and registers coherence or unity. Whereas you see, readerly text is closed one and the writerly text is open one. So once reader has formed his opinion or he draw certain meaning out of the text, that is the closed one. And then there is a third text is also involved in this, matter, and that is the producerly text. And the producerly text combines televisual characteristics of writerly text with the easy accessibility of the readerly one. So here you see producer and director of a certain television program, they are well aware of the required and needs of, or we can say the test of his audience. So according to that, they mold a writerly text and they base their idea for the television program. So in this way, producerly text is also there on the above level. And here, this producerly text relies on discursive competencies that the viewers already possess. Very importantly, the reader's understanding, reader's test, reader's approach that is considered while preparing a final script for the production of a television program, which is considered as the producerly text. Then John Pliskin talks about television and oral culture. Now here, television distinctive textual characteristics, unlike literature or film, have derived from a popular culture in which orality plays a central role. So you see, different television programs are based on folklore, or you can say the popular, you say, tradition or popular, you say, media of people. In this way, television's openness, its textual contradictions and instability enable it to be readily incorporated into a form of folklore. So in this way, since it is based on folklore, based on popular culture, so television's openness is very easy to gather with, or it is very easy to make up with. Writer then in the next chapter discusses about intertextuality. Now again, intertextuality is a literary theory introduced by Julio Cristeva. The theory of intertextuality proposes that any one text is necessarily read in relationship to the other text, and that a range of textual knowledge is brought to bear upon it. So in this way, one text is understood in relationship with other text, and that other text may be a kind of an event, kind of a story, kind of a narrative available in the society. And in this way, this intertextuality has been introduced. The same phenomenon or same idea has been introduced in case of the television program. So most of the stories of narration adopted for television program are intertextual in nature. The writer have find out the horizontal intertextuality and the vertical intertextuality in the television programs. So what is horizontal textuality? So here you see that in a certain serial, a certain character is appeared. For considering he is a hero. The hero is appeared in one serial. The same hero is appear in other, you see, program as the host. Or he is also appear in a certain quiz, you say, a program or quiz, you say, television serial. So in this way, a same hero is available in multiple episodes or multiple serials in different aspect of role. And in this way, a horizontal intertextuality has been created. So here viewers is open to connect one role of a character which is role in another serial. And in this way, intertextuality has been developed by the writer, reader. Then there is a second vertical intertextuality is there. It is found when a book makes a reference to film or a song or vice versa. So in case of vertical intertextuality, a particular television program has intertextual with or has a connection with a film or a certain program. Or you can say that there is a vice versa relationship between movie and a television program. And this way, vertical intertextuality has been introduced. Now here, what is important, vertical intertextuality consists of a primary textus relation with other texts. That is secondary text such as a criticism or publicity. So here you see the television program is obviously the part of the criticism or you say publicity, you say sort of element, and in this way there is a connection has been established. Then there is a tertiary level text is also available, and that is the third level of intertextuality of television. Now, what is the tertiary level of text of intertextuality? These are the texts that our viewers make themselves out of their responses. Now here you see, viewers have their own understanding. They have multiple stories or their own experiences of their own life. So whatever television program is presenting before the audience, the audience here applies their own experiences with the event. And in this way, a tertiary level text of intertextuality has been introduced by readers or viewers, we can say. In the next chapter, writer talks about narrative. Now, narrative is very important. You say term we have discussed in our literature. Now, narrative can be any, story or any form of, story present in mythology, legend, fable, tale, novella, epic, history, and so on. So you say narrative is a kind of a story available everywhere. And this is the first and foremost a prodigious variety of genres, which is able to carried by articulated language, fixed and moving images and gestures. So you see, with the help of language, okay, it is able to carry articulated language and could present a moving images and gesture. This is what the potential narrative has. Also, like language, narrative is a basic way of making sense of our experience of the real. Now you see, in our life, we experience the reality. Many real aspects are there, realism-based aspects are there. So narrative is helping us to make sense of those real experiences. And now here, television drama, according to John Fiske, news and many commercial or rock videos are also narrative in mode, because news also carry a kind of a story behind it. They have its own agenda to represent a certain event. Okay. Similarly, many commercial advertisements or rock videos, they also have a narrative. So like a small advertisement, it also comes up with a kind of a narrative. Then John Fiske here talks about the features of classic realist narrative. And he gives four important features. The first is linearity of cause and effect. So you see, in any narrative, like in any story, the theory of cause and effect is working. Like we have seen in parable or Shakespearean drama, we have seen like how a central character falls from his moral values and then he suffers, you see, the tragedy towards the end. So the cause and effect is working in this drama. So here you see, Kuhn is, you say, find out the linearity of cause and effect in this narrative. The second feature he counted, the high degree of narrative closure. So you see, the narrative has a kind of a closure. Okay, so you see, on one hand, narrative is open-ended, but on the other hand, it is closed-ended. So certain aspects are closed, or certain aspect of a narrative has been decided. The third feature is this, fictional world governed by spatial and temporal truth. So the truth, as a viewer, we experience, the same truth has been taken into consideration for the television program. The fourth feature of narrative is this, centrality of narrative agency of psychologically rounded character. You see, the characters are psychologically presented. The personality is developed through certain, you say, dialogues and conversation. So in this way, the centrality of narrative agency of psychologically rounded characters is there. Then writer John Fiske talks about mythic narrative. Now here, what he observes, myths work to naturalize history. Like many mythological stories and epics are very popular in each culture. And these epics or narrative, they helps to naturalize history of that particular group. And history is the accumulated social experience that has produced the divisions and differential power relationship of our society, and thus form an essential base for understanding the society. So you see, any society which is generated out of historical processes, and in that historical processes, we say the categorization or classification has done. And in this way, the higher classes and lower classes, and we say the hierarchy of the structure of society has been developed. And in this way, this helps us understand that hierarchical powers or power equations between the classes. Then here, John Fiske, taking idea of props, syntagmatic structuralist analysis. And then he discusses the television program and its narrative structure. So the television program carries a kind of a structure. Like you see, like when we study Aristotelian concept of six element of drama. So here we can get the idea of the structure of drama, like the beginning and then the rising of action, then there is a climax, then there is a falling of action, and then catastrophe. So similarly, the narrative adopted for a teleprogram, it has a certain set, you say, structure. So in the beginning, prop find out there is a preparation, like in introduction, like one of the family member leaves his home, certain rules and regulations are imposed upon him. Then there is the entry of villain, and he identifies his victim, and then he started deceiving them. Meanwhile, we see that the victim or the hero, he came in contact with the villain, and unknowingly he extended his help to him. Then begins the complication. Now here, villain started harming the family members of hero. And then the misfortune of family members out of lack of desire. So out of lack of desire of coming out of the situation, or you say overcoming the situation, the family members suffers misfortune. And in this way, then there is a role of hero is there, and he plans against the villain. Then on the third level, the transference is there. So here you see, he will lose the hope. Okay, and then he testified, he passed through different hardships. And then finally, you see, he landed to a certain place where from he got some powers. And then with the power he come back, and then there is a struggle between the hero and the villain. Okay, there is a direct combat. And then hero is branded, villain is defeated. And in this way, the initial misfortune which was introduced, that has been corrected by the hero. On the fifth level, props find out the structure with a return. Again, after winning over the villain, the hero come back to his family. But here there is a problem there, because meanwhile, a duplicate of hero, he already took his position in the family. And in this way, because of the lapse of many years, family members have forgotten the hero, or they have disconnected from him for many years, and this is the reason why they were unable to recognize the hero. But somehow, you say, some elements have been introduced by dramatist or script writer, and family member, they do recognize the hero finally. Okay, in this way, recognition is introduced in the drama. In this way, preparation, complication, transference, struggle, return, and recognition, this is the structure of a narrative adopted for the television drama. Now here, in the next chapter, John Fiske discuss about the narrative course. And to discuss this, he adopted the theory of Rolla Barthes' book, SJ, which was published in 1975. And here Rolla Barthes chose five narrative codes, and he called it as the micro grammar. The first one is symbolic code. Now, what is symbolic code? It organizes the fundamental binary oppositions. You see, to draw certain meaning, we do apply certain binary opposites, like day and night, red and black, white and black. So in this way, the binary opposites are introduced to, draw certain meaning. So this is called as symbolic code. Then there is second code is there, that is called as semic code, or the voice of the person. It works in a similar way to construct the meaning of a character, object, and setting. Then there is a third code is introduced by the Barthes, and that is referential code. That referential code, through which a text refers out beyond itself. So in this way, this referential code helps us understand the situation relating the present situation in the television drama with our own experiences. In this way, we refer to understand or draw certain meaning by applying our knowledge or experiences from outside. Then the fourth code is the code of action. Now, what is code of action? It suggests that we understand any action in the narrative by our experience of family action in other narrative. In this way, our knowledge of other narrative is always there. And from that knowledge, we relate the present situation or present television, you say, situation, and we draw certain meaning. So this is what a code of action. So here, people is in action, you can say. And the fifth code is the hermeneutic code. This code sets and resolves the enigmas of the narrative. Now you see, narrator has projected some problem, and then heroines go on solving that problem and enigmas. And in this way, the entire structure is working, go on functioning. And then finally, you say hero and heroine succeed in solving that enigma. So here, hermeneutic code has been introduced by writer in the drama, okay, to solve certain enigmas or problems. Now, our next level, John Fiske discusses character reading. Television is centrally concerned with the representation of people. You see, already the base of television drama is none other than the society and its reality. So obviously, the characters are taken for the television program, they are taken from the society itself. So its most typical image is a mid shot or close up of someone's talking or reacting. So you see, to project someone or to, you say, introduce some character, some shot has been given. In this way, 2-3 shots are given to a certain character until his personality has been introduced. So in this way, special relationship and location, and then camera moves in on to the individual. Once the personality has been introduced, when the viewers are understood the personality, then the camera move on to the further situation. So in this way, the character reading is important, and the character need to be established properly for the readers. The realness given to the character by its merging with the players, combined with its familiarity and its newness. So you see, the scriptwriter, they do take advantage of viewer's knowledge. So obviously, while projecting certain character, so his characterliness, or you can say the basic, you say, nature, it has been taken into consideration. That we call as stock character. We already have discussed this in the previous lecture, stock character. So here, stock characters are very much familiar to each and everyone. So we know that the wickedliness of someone, okay, some you say hot tempered, you say some intellectual person, some madly. So there are variety of, you say, characters are there which are called as stock characters. So here, scriptwriter is taken into consider all these stock characters to present his, you say, character in the television program. And in this way, it is very easy for readers or viewers to, guess or understand that character. In this, you say, television program, the identification, implication, and ideology, these are working. And in this way, certain characters are identified with this idea. Then you see, the ideologically dominant reading and acting strategies are those of realism. So the ideological dominant reading and acting strategies are coming from realism. Okay. They work to suppress the socio-political meaning of the text in favor of the individualistic, and promotes a particular relationship of the viewer to the text. In this way, a certain character has been projected, and while doing so, it suppresses the socio-political meaning of the text. So here you can see that text has been compromised doing this. So this relationship is often called as identification. Sometimes viewers do understand that as to why this kind of projection has made in the television program by the script writers or producers. So this is what the identification. So here, viewer is aware of the motive behind such projection. Then there is a psychological identification is there. So this psychological identification has taken from the idea of Sigmund Freud. Now, what is identification for Freud? It was the projection of personal characteristics onto an external body or object in order to understand them better. So here you see, to understand a certain character, projection of a personal characteristic has been applied. Okay, so as a viewer, we are also capable of doing this. So we understand the psychological, preparation of a particular character. We do understand as to the way he move in action. So we redundantly, we find it results, or we do guess as to where this action will take the characters to. And in this way, there is a psychological identification has formed. So here you see, many viewers report that one of the main source of the pleasure of television is the opportunities it offers to identify with certain characters and to share their emotion and experiences. So many a times viewer, they themselves identify themselves with certain character or with certain situation. And in this way, when this identification has established, pleasure develops. And in this way, viewers, they enjoy the drama or television program. And in this way, they attach themselves with it. So what is implication works here? total identification in which the beaver is lost in the represented character or world occur, but it happens rarely. So that is called an implication. Okay, sometimes certain characters are identified beaver by beaver 100% close, but this happens very rarely. But if it happens, it is called an implication. Then there is an ideological identification is there, because sometimes a certain ideology has been projected through the narrative or a television program. And then sometimes beaver do follow that ideology, and this way ideological identification has been introduced. Then very important chapter is there, that is called as gendered television femininity. So you see, sometimes gender as the subject matter or subjectivity has been considered for television programs. And then obviously femininity has been discussed widely, or you can say in a detailed way. Different, you say, expert has been invited, and then the anchor who is there, he has his own personal, approach to the discussion. Okay, that approach we have to find out here. John Fiske basically is pointing out the intention of the anchor, because he has certain agenda behind it. On one hand, the anchor allows the speakers to explore radically over the subject of femininity, obviously against the patriarchy. But then he certainly sees to it that the patriarchy has not been challenged. In this way, the working of this discussion is going on. So even if the subject like gender is there, so here you see they upheld the importance to the gender study or the subject matter of gender, or even the television makers or television program makers, they do certainly support the gender subject. Okay, but at the same time, they see to it the patriarchy has not been severely wounded. Okay, so patriarchal dominance in directly or indirectly way kept as it is. Then there is another chapter devoted to here on the masculinity, or again we can say that gendered television and masculinity. So here masculinity also introduced similarly as the femininity. But you see, in case of femininity, now writer has to introduce many aspects so that you say dissent would be there, or writer has many things to introduce so that every viewer or every participant may have his own say to make into it. But in case of masculinity, since masculinity is aligned with the patriarchy, so here you see there is no double text has been a need of double text of double text is to be introduced by the writer. So here you see what John Fiske maintained over here is that texts are structured to produce greater narrative and ideological closure, which is not registered by audiences. So here, since gendered discussion related to masculinity has this ideological closure, and then left no option for audiences to make their, you say, make their comment on it. So here, no scope has been left for resistance by the resistance from the audience. So further, John Fiske points out that masculine texts appear to be less polysemic than feminine ones, because masculinity's relationship to patriarchy is less registered than the femininity's. You see, feminine subject of femininity subject has many things or multiple aspects of, you say, subject. And then there is, resistances to the patriarchy. But in case of masculinity, there is less chances of, you say, double text and resistances, since it is aligned with the patriarchy. After this chapter, John Fiske brings very important chapter, and that is the pleasure and play. Because in every television program, it is, prepared in such a way that audiences may enjoy the entire program. They draw certain pleasure out of it. So here you see, for many viewers, television is a source of pleasure. Okay, if they are in stress, they have done the hard work of a day, and in the evening they wanted to relax, sit relax before television and to enjoy certain program. In this way, television provided a kind of a solace and pleasure to the audience. Here, the psychoanalytic use of term pleasure tends to relate it with our desire and places it as the main motivator of human action. Okay, now this theory again is taken from Sigmund Freud by John Fiske. And here, pleasure is related to the desire, our desire. And this desire is a kind of a main motivator of our action, because we want something and we do, consider some action for it. So in this way, desire or pleasure is play a kind of a role as the desire. Now here, John Fiske considers some terminology used by Rolla Barth. So Rolla Barth uses the term plaisir, and it is refers to the pleasure. And then he introduces another term, that is joyousness. It is refers to physical pleasure. So here, plaisir is essentially cultural oriented, and joyousness is referred to the physical pleasure oriented. So in this way, three categories have been introduced. Number one is psychoanalytic, number two physical, and third is social. So on this three level, pleasure had been derived or introduced through the television program. Typical pleasure of television is the playful pleasure that derives from and enacts the sources of all powers for subordinate. So you see, sometimes some television series are prepared in such a way that, you see, the subordinate identifies certain ideology or certain characters, and they enjoy the, you say, television program. And in this way, a typical pleasure of television has been introduced. What television basically offers the viewer two sort of producerly pleasure. Number one, the one is the pleasure of making subculturally pertinent meaning. And then second one is the pleasure in the process of making meaning. Okay, so these are the television-based pleasure offered by television. And then there is a third pleasure is there, and that is the ideological pleasure of recognition that I have already discussed earlier. Okay, now here you see certain ideologies have been introduced to certain television program, and viewers do identify or they follow that certain ideology, and in this way they get immersed, or you say they occupied in the theme of the television program. Then next level, you say some kind of, you say, quizzes and games as a show introduced in television program. And they are also yielding into certain television pleasures or quizzical pleasures. So we can see that, like Kaun Banega Crorepati, we enjoy this serial. Then there are certain quizzes and games are there, masculinity based games are there, or feminine based game are there, and through which also we draw some pleasure. So you see, the grounding of these physical pleasures is in oral culture, gives them a vitality and strongly interactive relationship with the viewer. You see, these quizzes and game shows are based upon the popular oral culture. They are already available in our society in different forms. And in this way, viewers do find certain connection and do enjoy the modified form or transform, you say, form of the quizzes and the game show in television. Quiz show basically having ritual, particularly at the beginning and at the end. But here, what John Fiske find it, these are the, you say, rituals of the enactment of capitalist ideology. In this way, in the beginning and in the end, some big, you say, capitalist ideologue or you say some big pastry persons will be introduced, okay? And this way, it is the enactment of capitalist ideology, where the show is full of, you say, a commercialization of it, or material aspect will be involved in this, you say, closure and the introduction of the program. The structure of this show reproduces the education system in Western society. Now here, what is the structure of Quiz Show? Now this is very important, because what John Fiske found behind it, or the intention behind projecting quizzes and game shows, is there. So it is very stunning result we found at the end. So here, in case of discussing about the structure, what John Fiske found, the structure of quiz show reproduce the education system in Western society. Now in this, you say all the participants had been invited for a particular quiz. And then one of the person will win over, or he will pass through struggle and difficulties, and finally he'll be succeed. So the succeed person will be awarded with high income jobs or position with social power and influence. Okay. Like you see Indian Idol, one of the participants will be declared winner, and then he will be offered with some Bollywood, you say, big budget movie songs as a singer. In this way, there are variety of quiz shows and game shows are there, and towards the end, when a winner is there, the winner will be awarded with some big, you say, influential award. But here, what problem is this? Such an ideology and ritual game performances with a social or a class differences naturalize the class system. Now here, very problem is this, these quiz shows and game shows are based upon naturalizing the class system. Now, certain people are influential because they are talented or they are lucky enough to get that position, but others are not. Okay, and in this way, it validates the hierarchical system of a society. Certain are rich, why? Because they are entitled to that. Certain are poor, why? Because they are entitled to that. In this way, game shows and its, I mean, structure or basic, you say, is there to naturalize this class system. So lucky is the very important factor works in case of game show or quiz show. Because finally, what happens? A loser will sympathize himself with the idea that why someone is a winner, it's not because he's intellectual or intelligent or clever, but why? Because luck is with him. I was not lucky enough. So luck plays a vital role in hegemonic structure of societies that are both competitive and democratic. Okay, so on one hand, dominant ideology maintains that they are allowing each and everyone to participate in the game and to win over, unlike the society which, you say, sets that watertight compartment and doesn't allow person to go out of that class. In this way, this dichotomy is there. Okay, so dominant ideology created an air of projected an equality, but basically they are there to support the class system and to naturalize it. And this way, game shows and quiz shows are there to naturalize the classes and the class system. Then, John Fiske discusses about commodities involved in television programs. The commercial interest behind quiz shows, as behind so much of television, press to have their good displays to an audience of billions. So you see, certain, game show is there, and what will be the final trophy will be there. Like in cricket shows, we have seen that a car will be displayed. This will be given to the man of the match or man of the series, like that. So in this way, in each show, in each quiz show, some of the other products are offered to the person, like a man of the day or a singer of a day or a participant of a day. And then he will be given with some hampers, gift hampers. Okay, so in this way, goods have been displayed through the program. Okay, so basically, this quiz show and game shows are there to display what the commercial products. So here, quiz shows like advertising are undoubtedly part of commodity, capitalism, and use many of similar cultural strategies. For instance, glamorous models are used to display the prices and thus associate commodities with sexuality. And in this way, they trap much audiences. Like some popular Hollywood or Bollywood heroine will be introduced there, or she will be there to present that gift hamper to the audience, to the participant. Okay, and in this way, the sexuality has been associated with the commodity to promote it. So this is also a kind of a strategy adopted in commercial. Then John Plisket talks about the active audience. Okay, now here, what active audience is there? Like in quiz show, participant is a viewer, or a viewer is also there who is sitting at a remote place. So he also has been participate in the game. Like we say, Kon Banega Crorepati. So participant is sitting before Amitabh Bachchan on the hot seat. But at the same time, in the break, Amitabh Bachchan gives a question or a quiz to the audience to solve it and to return or the answer it within a week. And then the person who give correct answer will be awarded with certain gift hamper. So in this way, in the quiz show and in game show, active audience has been, you say, considered. Like in Kapil Sharma show, you say audience is there and it is constantly being involved. Okay, so they interacted with the characters on the stage show. In this way, active audience has been introduced in game shows, quiz shows, and shows like Kapil Sharma. Then another chapter is there based upon news reading and news readers. So this is a very important genre of television program. Now sometimes we see that there was a time when one television channel is having everything else. They have movies, they have television programs, serials, episodes, news, etc., etc. But now a news channel are there independently talking about news only or narrating news only, day and night. Okay. So news is a high status television genre because it claimed impartial, argued to be essential for the working of a democracy. We call it as a third pillar of the democracy. Okay. Why it is called as third pillar? Because it is impartial and it talks about a situation in favor of people. But what John Biskay is found it is a half narrative or half story, because they are not impartial totally, but partiality is involved in news channels. So news is also a commodity because it is also sold, because certain programs are there has certain number of viewership. On the basis of that, it has been sold to the advertisers. For events seem to be part of nature, whereas the telling of stories and the selection of the key events are clearly cultural activity. So you see, different elements or different events has been chosen for the news channel. And they are around the cultural activities so that, you say, viewers may attach to it. The popularity of the news is determined largely by its generic characteristics, which constitute the strategies of containment which attempt to control reality. Now here you see different way of debates and discussion will be conducted on a certain issue happened within the 24 hours. But again, here the intention behind it, or the news anchor will always control the reality, because what reality is there will not be exposed as it is, but it is reflected through the news media in such a way that it is to be presented to the audiences. So a certain agenda is fixed, a certain aspect of news is fixed, and that is what the narrator is, attached with. And he has to narrate the event in that way only, hiding the real or hiding the reality. Then there are categorizations of news are there. Okay, like you see, we see number of modes of news are there. Okay, like sport news is there, cultural news is there, political news is there, international news is there. So different way of news are there and they are categorized. And it has set with a strategy. Each news channel has a strategy to, telecast or narrate events and different news of category. So here, unlike literature, news stories are metaphors that are so conventional that they have become cliche. Now, cliches means here, kind of repetition of certain ideas will be presented before ideas to hammer. And in this way, it maintains the relationship with the dominant ideology. Okay, so the through cliche, the news channel will repeatedly, present certain news in certain aspect so that the dominant ideology will be maintained. And here, the metaphorical nature is consequently unrecognized. So we are still, as a viewer struck with the event, we are unaware the motive of the news anchor is still regulating his dominant ideology through the news channel. So in this way, very subtly, news channel reporters are maintaining the dominant ideology behind certain event narratives. So what is the role of the news? Here, John Fiske maintains the main narrative energy in news lies in the central section in which the forces of disruption are explored and their conflict with the social order is enacted. So you see, certain news is there, stand between two forces, right wing and the left wing. Or you say dominant class versus the dominated class. And in this way, the news is created in such a way that it is exploring the all possible, narration. Okay, and very subtly, again, it is focusing upon the central section. Okay, and then central section is relying on, again, the dominant ideology. Now here, the social experiences that news brings to us is itself uncontrollable. Now there is no control to the news channel. You see, in India also, we have seen that debate has been created. News channels are uncontrolled. Even the government is not able to control the news media. They are go on, entering into the personal life of people in so excessive way that the victim or the person involved in certain, crime, they are harassed by news channels. So in this way, the narration is also go uncontrollably vague. Okay, what narration is there related to certain person may not be true. After some time, we come to know that what narrative said by news channel comes, not proved by the channel. Okay, so it is untrue. So, news channels are there which are uncontrollable, what John Fiske found out. News can never give a full and accurate objective picture of reality for such an enterprise. Can only serve to increase its authority and decrease the people's opportunity to argue with it or to negotiate it. You see, in case of news narration, they left very less chances or space for viewers to interrogate or intervene in it. The narrative is set in such a way that they silences the audiences. Sometimes nationalism, sometimes patriotism is a subject matter which overlaps the viewer's dissent. So in a progressive democracy, news should space its expansion. Now here, John Fiske has his own opinion about news media. Okay, what he opined as, in a progressive democracy, news should space its expansive constructiveness, should nominate all its voices, should open its text to invite more producerly reading relations. Now here, to foster democracy, it is important to give voices to the dissent. It is important to accumulate the voices, Okay, so this is what the opinion of John Fiske. And now, in the 16th chapter, that is the concluding chapter, John Fiske talks about the popular economy. Or here, in the conclusion, pondering over the idea of economy behind the television program. Now, what he, what are his findings? Number one, the capitalist culture in this space produced the same capitalist ideology. So obviously, when a capitalist industry will try to, you say, create a gesture that they are offering certain social work or social welfare work, so behind that also, they have capitalist ideology to promote certain product or to promote certain capitalist, ideology. So it is a kind of a sugar-coated pills they give to the audience, and the audience remains unaware of the intention behind capitalist industry. Then John Fiske further maintains the interest of the producer and distributor of a cultural commodity is one of the head counting. The greater the head count, the greater the popularity. So you see, whenever a television program has made, so they see to it what will be the target audience they are going to get. And obviously, any television program will see to it they gather large number of viewers so that they can sell it to the advertiser and they get more advertisement to the income or the revenue generated out of that television program. In this way, the greater the head count, the greater the popularity of the television program, and obviously the more economy involves in it. Then John Fiske discusses about the people. Okay, what is people? He defines it, people is the constantly changing concept. Okay, because people is something to the capitalist society, and people is something to bourgeois society, capitalist is something to the marginalized community. Okay, so it has meaning and it changes according to the situation. So here the term people then refers to the social group that are relatively powerless and they have cultural forms and interests of their own that differs from and often conflict with those of the producers of cultural commodities. So in this way, here the clash of the cultures has been, discussed about the writer in case of the people. So here you see the powerless are often collide with the producers of the cultural commodities. Now here cultural commodities are there to introduce the capitalist intention, materialist intention, and this is the reason why there is a resistance always there from the subordinated class or powerless class. So here John Fiske talks about two economies. The cultural commodity differs from other commodities in having comparatively high initial production cost and very low reproduction cost. So distribution offers a safer return on investment than production. So in case of producing a particular television program, so the production cost is higher than the investment cost. So obviously, investors will be at the at the level of advantage, we can say, than the producer or the production team. So this book, according to John Fiske, has argued that the power of audiences as producer in the cultural economy is considerable. So audiences are also as a producer, and they are the part of economy, cultural economy. This power derives from the fact that millions do not circulate in the cultural economy in the same way that wealth does in the financial. The further finding of John Fiske is this: the popular cultural capital consists of the meanings and pleasures available to the subordinate to express and promote their interest. So you see, popular cultural capitals, two different popular television serials. So you see, it has or it carries, you say, pleasures for the subordinate classes. And then there is a scope of space left for them to express themselves or to promote their interests. Any form of capital, either economic capital or the cultural capital of the bourgeoisie, it works through ideology. So ideology at the center behind the economic capital or the cultural capital. These ideologies that empower the subordinate enable them to produce sensitive meaning. You see, these are the ideologies empower the subordinate class and also gives pleasure that are the form of a social power. Further finding of John Fiske's day, television uses the power of surveillance. Now, television is a very crucial, media. Okay, and it is used by the government or some powerful agency, capitalistic agencies, for a number of ways. So, one of the use of television is the power of surveillance. Okay, so here power uses its surveillance capacity to make a surveillance upon the society so that his product may conveniently be sold out. Then revealing the world. So television reflects the world. Then spying out people's secrets. So sometimes we see that Sex and City talks about, that's a popular American television serial, okay, talks about or gossips about the hero and heroine and their private life. Then monitoring human activity. The television also helps in monitoring the human activity. But an integral part of it, this power is resistance, and rather resistance is good. But in spite of that, you see, the power of resistance it allows to the viewers. Then John Fiske maintained the two-way nature of power means that its resistances are themselves multiple points of power. The power, paradoxically, can thus liberate people from its own force to subject and discipline them. In this way, power helps people discipline themselves, okay, with the subject. Now here, John Fiske further categorized power into two classes. First is semiotic power. Now what is semiotic power? The power to construct meaning, pleasure, and social identities. So a viewer has this kind of potential to construct a meaning, draw pleasures, and identify certain ideology or factor or event with him. Then another class is there of power, the social power, the power to construct a socio-economic system. Okay, so in this way, social power is there used or you say considered for the formation of or creation of a television program, okay, to foster or to construct a socio-economic system. Further, noting made by John Fiske is this: popular culture that works in the interest of subordinate is often a provoker of fantasy. Such fantasy is a direct response to the dominant ideology and its embodiment in social relations. Okay, in case of certain television program based on certain fantasy, and that fantasy is sold to the viewers. Okay, viewers under that fantasy, okay, is a direct response to the dominant ideology. Okay, such fantasy is a direct response to the dominant ideology and its embodiment in social relations. So here you see that a subordinate viewer or subordinated class will find certain powers with them to counter the capitalist ideology or dominant ideology. So fantasy works here as a tool to the power. A diversity of programs deliberately constructed by television producer and scheduler in an attempt to segment the audience into the markets required by advertisers. So obviously some programs are there made or you can say manufactured in the interest of, you say, requirements of the market. Okay, Now, what market is required? Certain products are to be launched. Okay, and in this way, certain programs are there. Like Kapil Sharma show is there, always promoting certain movies. Okay, so every day you see a certain movie has been discussed. So all the important characters will be invited there, and they promote their movie to the audiences through the show. So in this way, promotion or requirement of the market is always there behind the composition of or creation of a television program. Then, what is the further notice of John Fiske is a national culture which is constructed by cultural industries, politicians, cultural lobbyists may not tend to be most productive by subordinate groups within the nation. Now you see, sometimes national culture has been upheld. Some patriotic aspects are there. Or many times a dominant ideology has comes up with certain ideas, but it may or may not be supported by the subordinated groups because they are marginalized in the same system and they do find problems with that. So in this way, some programs are there which created a tussle or which created, you say, resistance from a certain subordinate groups. Then, final, conclusion made by John Fiske here, attempts to produce or defend a national culture, whether by a national broadcasting system or other means, have historically been dominated by middle class. You say, whatever national interest, you say, program is there related to the national culture, it is highly dominated by the middle class of the country. Thus, it is almost without exception that in countries that have both a nationalistic public broadcasting system and a commercial one, like we do have DD National, Doordarshan, and its state-wise channels. At the same time, we see there are popular private channels are there. But you see, many television programs of the popular private channels are more popular than the national broadcasting channel like Doordarshan. So why? Because it has certain aspect behind it, what John Fiske found. So that the commercial one will be more popular with the subordinated groups. Now, why it is popular with the subordinated group? Because they find their voice in the serial or in the television program, but they don't find voices in the state-sponsored, you say, broadcasting system. So television must, now here, final opinion made by John Fiske is there. He maintained that television as a popular mass media must link forces of capital and the people to circulate effectively in both financial and cultural economics. So, for John Fiske, television is a popular mass media and it must link forces of capital and the people to circulate effectively in both financial and economical economics. So here, while projecting the ideologies or capitalist ideologies, the interest of the subordinated group or interest of common people should not be dominated. Okay, so there should be a balance presented by the television program. This is what expectation of John Fiske from television. With this, this book, Television Culture, is come to the conclusion, and discussion on this television culture is completed over here. If you have any question query, you can ask me, or you can keep posting your questions and doubts related to the topic on cultural studies and John Fiske's television culture, and I'll be answering it anytime through our medium of present. Thank you for listening to me and giving me a patient listening throughout these two lectures on cultural studies and John Fiske's television culture. We'll meet in the another series of lectures on some subject related to our syllabus.